Good morning.
Brother Eli, would you collect us on the spot?
Can anyone tell me what major topic we're talking about? We're talking about being a Pentecostal powerhouse. And what do we mean by a powerhouse? Well, we're not looking at it from an electric plant standpoint, but we're looking at it as from the standpoint of the individual who's constantly going to the gym and working out. They're constantly becoming stronger. They're constantly becoming mightier. They're working on this part of their body. They're exercising that part of the body. In essence, they're the people that don't skip leg day. That seems to be the running joke for people who work out. Don't skip leg day. But they're constantly working to achieve a goal. Whether they might have been overweight in the past, maybe they're just getting in shape. But whatever it is, they have a goal and they're going to become somebody who's not to be messed with. I remember someone saying, my uncle told a story a little bit back, how he was in the prison and I guess a fight broke out between two inmates. And his boss was saying about they had to get someone down there. And they said, well, Layton's down there. Well, he can take care of himself. If you've known my uncle Doug for any number of years, he used to be into weightlifting and all that. And if you look at him now, he's not a small man to begin with, not somebody to tangle with. But that didn't happen overnight. Most people who work out overnight, who become weightlifters and everything else, it doesn't happen like that. There was a woman I went to college with. If you look at her now versus 10 years ago, completely different person. When she was in college with me in 2003, I guess that's more than 10 years now, she was on the heavy side. Now she's into deadlifts and dropping them, and she's a whole different person. Why? Because she constantly went to the gym. She kept working out. She kept pushing herself. She got involved in trying to make her body stronger, getting more in shape. Got to the point where she hired a personal trainer to help her train for deadlifts. Why? Because she had a goal and she was going for it. How does that apply to us? Well, when we look and read the book of Romans, the Bible states that you are either going to feed the flesh or you're going to feed the spirit. Whichever one you feed is going to become stronger. If you're going to become a Pentecostal powerhouse, it's not going to happen overnight. It doesn't happen and you wake up one day and all of a sudden you're the mightiest person spiritually ever that ever existed. It doesn't happen that way. When we look at the life of Samuel, I think it was Samuel who the king of the enemy, who was the enemy, accused spies within his realm of knowing his exact location and what he was going to be. And they said, no, it's this prophet Samuel way over the way. It was Elijah. You think that happened overnight for Elijah? No. It was a constant daily walk with God. It was constant prayer, finding time in prayer. It was him feeding the spiritual, training the spiritual, and not feeding and giving into the flesh. That is exactly what we're talking about. That's exactly what we're studying. Why? Because as Christians, we should not be content to be where we are now. But we should be constantly striving to be farther and more effective in the spirit than we are now. We often say, I am blessed that God gave me another day. Well, why did he give you another day? Did he give you another day for you? Or did he give you another day so you could reach someone else for him? You know, sometimes we get things a little distorted. Maybe God didn't give us another day for us. Not for us to live on this earth and see our grandkids one more time. But maybe he gave us one more day to reach out to one more person. Maybe he gave us one more day because maybe that day is going to be that person's last day. Mm-hmm. We need to make sure that we are training ourselves spiritually, that we are effective for the kingdom of God. Not because it's anything of us. It's all about Him. And because it's all about Him, in the words of the Apostle Paul, I strive for the mastery. I strive that I might obtain. Not because of who I am, and not because of someone else, but that what I do is for the glory of God. And what God wants is for us to reach the lost at any cost. When we look at the life of Jesus, why did the Son of God come to the earth? It wasn't to heal the sick. It wasn't to heal the lame. But it was to seek and to save those which are lost. If that was the mission of Jesus Christ, what do you think our mission is? To build the kingdom of God. And how can we effectively build the kingdom of God if we're not constantly striving to be who God wants us to be in the spiritual? There is coming a day when we will be known as we are in heaven. How are we known in heaven right now? How will we be known in heaven tomorrow? Are we known as that individual who's constantly striving, trying to allow the Holy Ghost to train us in the Spirit? S.M. Lockridge made this statement. He said, you can go to any seminary in the world and you will never find a course on prayer. Why? Because there's only one teacher, and that is the Holy Ghost. When it comes to being a Pentecostal powerhouse, I can try and encourage you. I can show you from the Word of God. I can try and show you what the Word of God says, try and give you illustrations. But when it comes down to it, guess who's the teacher? The Holy Ghost. I can only do so much in trying to encourage us to. But you can't teach me how to be used in the gifts of the Spirit. And I can't teach you how to be used in the gifts of the Spirit. Why? Because there's only one person who can train us in such a fashion, and that is the Holy Ghost. Sure, I can tell you how I feel God moving on me. Brother Eli, you can tell me how you feel God moving on you when you're about to give tongues. But who is the master teacher? It's the Holy Ghost. Because God moves on everyone individually. But we need to strive within ourselves that we may obtain. We are living in a church world that when we look around, how many people are truly being used for the glory of God? How many people really have the ear of God? God looks for an individual to stand in the gap. Are we willing to be that person? We began talking about signs and wonders and why we don't see them. We talked about the church world. And we talked about the need of We talk about our need to have a desire to see these things accomplished in our own lives. Because when we look at the church, wherever you go, even if the Sunday school teacher is not having signs and wonders follow him, even if the pastor is not having signs and wonders follow him or her, that doesn't mean that we can't have signs and wonders following us. You know, there are some people that are more spiritual that's in the pew than the leadership that leads them. And leadership doesn't hinder either one of us in any way. If we want to see God like never before, if we want to see signs and wonders happen in our lives, guess who it comes down to? It's not the pastor. It's not the Sunday school teacher. It's you. It's me in my own life. Why? Because we have to be willing to seek after God. We have to chase after God. What does the Bible state about those that hunger and thirst after God? They'll be filled. But when we look at hungering and thirsting, we can have a desire, but is it just a desire? No. It takes work. It takes effort. It takes going to the gym, working out, reading the Bible, praying. When we don't feel like praying, we press through. When we don't feel like praying more than 5 minutes, we pray a half an hour. When we don't feel like reading our Bible, we read a few chapters more. When we don't feel like going to church, we go to church anyhow. When we feel just blah, we don't want to do anything, we still turn on that sermon or that preacher that we might listen to anyhow that encourages us. It is a constant effort. People who go to the gym and work out and become become powerhouses, do they always go because they want to? No. Is pain involved when you go to the gym? It can be. I remember when I was in college, when I think it was my freshman year, I went to the gym. What's that?
Yes, there's pain.
Yes, there's pain. Freshman year, I went to the gym 5 days a week when I was at Women's Room. If I was there on the weekend, I think I went 6 days a week. And then when I got a busy course schedule, so I laid off for about a year. So I figured, I'll go back, Brother Eli. And the thing is, your mind tells you what I did before. So I did what I did before. And I remember coming to church that weekend, and I finally got my arms to here. I was in so much pain, and I was so stiff for about a week. Because I did what I did before, but I wasn't doing anything for about a year. And my body wasn't used to it. And I was sore. And I'm not lying, brother. My arms were stuck. It was horrible. I was proud when I got them so far. But how many of us as Christians, we do that? We might get serious with God for a little bit, but then we just stop off. Or we might have the desire to, but we don't make ourselves go through with it. Now, there is pain. There is agony. But if we are going to really hear the voice of God, if we're really going to see signs and wonders in our life, if we are going to become a Pentecostal powerhouse, we have to be the individuals who's willing to do whatever it takes that we see God move like never before, that we see the signs and wonders happening. And we began with a starting point. And what's the starting point? And we're going way back before prayer. Normally, the Christian responsible for the first place is prayer. But we start a little bit farther back with this series. And we started with faith. Without faith, we can do nothing. When it comes to accepting Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, it takes faith. Faith in believing that His Word is true. Faith in believing that He said that if we confess our sins, that He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Maybe when we kneel down at that altar, we will feel the Holy Ghost and the Shekinah come down, and we will know without a shadow of doubt that we're saved because we feel it on the inside. But do we always feel everything that God's doing in our life? Do we always feel what He's moving in our life, even in a mighty way? Not always. There have been times when I felt the Holy Ghost moving on me for interpretation or prophecy, and I've had the words, but I can't say that I got the Holy Ghost, you know, Brother Eli, weighing on me. You got to do this. But I knew that it was the Holy Ghost. We are not always going to feel the Holy Ghost when it comes to faith. But I often come back to, and I was thinking about this past week, did you ever do something as a kid that was completely stupid? And you remember what your mom and your dad said? You know better than that. They didn't say you feel better than that. You know better than that. What does the Word of God state concerning when it comes to the judgment seat? Or even this life? For a man to feel to know good and do it not to commit sin. No, it says for a man to know to do good and do not his sin. It doesn't say you're going to feel it. You already know you're not supposed to steal. You don't need the Holy Ghost to move upon you for that. You know. He might convict you before and deal with you, but He may not always. Why? Because you know. Faith is not a feeling aspect of it. It can be at times, but it is not always. It is a knowing aspect. But it's a matter of whether or not we step out in faith. What is faith? We'll talk about that definition of faith. What does faith and hope have in common?
Of
things to be seen. And I'm trying to get a little specific because I'm looking for a particular one. And we go back to Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. What does Hebrews 11 and verse 1 state? It hasn't happened yet. And you're right there, brother. I'm just looking for one word. I'll probably say it. And I'm not dogging you or anything, but faith.
Yeah,
substance could be translated into what word? Starts with a C.
Confidence.
Faith is confidence in knowing what God has said is true. As we were getting to moving on towards the end of last week, we were getting into the enemy of fear. And we began talking about that a little bit. Let me get to the right notes. So faith is confidence. Confidence in knowing that God's word is true. Confidence of believing that when mom or dad say you're going to have that cookie, you're going to get that cookie. You may not know when you're going to get it, but you know if they said it's going to happen, it's going to happen. It is believing it's going to happen. Last week we began talking about the foe of faith. And what is the foe of faith? Doubt. Doubt is the foe of faith. If we would put doubt and confidence on a scale, where do we find them? We're not going to find them in the same location, but rather they're complete opposites. Either you have confidence in something, or you doubt it. You're not sure. There is no in between. Doubt is the enemy of faith. Why? Because doubt has no place with confidence. It is the farthest thing from it. It is the opposite of it. It is the enemy of it. If I'm confident when I go out there that I am going to open up my car door and my door is going to open, then I'm good. I believe it. You're not going to sway me any other way. Now, if I go out and open up my rear door and expect to have confidence that my rear window is not going to fall down, right now I have confidence it's not going to happen. I'm not going to doubt it in any way. You would have got me about 3 weeks ago, I would have doubted it. I would not have been confident. I would not have had faith that that window would have stayed up. Confidence and doubt do not go hand in hand. They are opposite. Either you're going to doubt or you're going to be confident in something. Faith and hope are confidence. That's all that they're surrounded with is confidence. And Jesus said in Matthew chapter 17, 20, and I know I'm taking a review a little bit longer, but I'm just trying to let everything sink in and stir the pot a little bit. Jesus said that if we have faith the size of a mustard seed, we can move mountains. He likened faith to the size of a mustard seed. How large is a mustard seed? Well, we took the words of Jesus Christ last week, and he said that this mustard seed is the smallest of all the herb seeds. It's the smallest. But yet, if you allow it to grow, birds come and rest under the shadow of its branches. That should be a mind-blowing aspect in the fact that our faith, if we have just the size of a small mustard seed, Jesus uses birds in his illustration. Well, what do birds eat? Seeds. But yet, if we allow the Holy Ghost to build our faith, those birds can't harm them in that faith in any way. In fact, it's more powerful than the birds because they come and lodge underneath it. They can rest on the branches, and the branches aren't going to break. They can nip and peck at the branches, but they're not going to do anything to it. That mustard seed has already bloomed and blossomed far beyond its state of vulnerability. But yet, even in that vulnerable state, faith has more power than anyone could ever dream of. But it comes down to the factor of, are we doubting, or do we have confidence in God's word? Because doubt is the foe of faith. When we doubt, we do not really possess faith at all. And I'm not going to have us read these verses because we read them last week. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 19 and 20, the disciples were trying to cast out a demon. Jesus was off in the wilderness during the temptation. And he comes back, and The disciples asked him, "Lord, why could we not cast out this demon?" And the very first thing he says is, "Because you doubt." He then goes farther and corrects them and say that someone comes out not by prayer and fasting. But he didn't come out and say right away, "Well, this kind of doesn't come out by prayer and fasting. You guys were good." He said, "You guys doubt. That's why it didn't come out. It's because you doubt." Why is that the problem? Because doubt is the enemy of faith. They didn't believe that they could cast out that demon. If they were doing it in the name of Jesus, they might not believe that they would have been able to cast it out in the name of Jesus. They doubted. If we go a little bit farther, we find that Jesus told them if they have faith enough, they can pull up a sycamore, have a sycamore tree plucked up by its roots. But they couldn't doubt. Faith is believing that no matter what the situation looks like, God's word is true. What does Matthew chapter 21 and 22 say? And someone else find Mark 11:24.
"And all things whatsoever ye ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive."
"And whatsoever ye ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive." Notice he said believing. He didn't use the word doubting. He said believing. If we doubt that we have anything in prayer, should we expect to receive it? No, because we don't have faith we're going to receive in the first place. We don't have faith in this verse. We don't have faith in the Word of God. Jesus said, "Whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall have it." Now, I'm not saying go down and lay your hands on the newest Mustang or convertible or Camaro or Corvette, whatever your tastes are, pickup truck, 350. I'm not preaching blood out of God. What I'm telling you is what the Word of God states. I mean, it talks more about prayer and that we ask according to His will, but if you're asking according to His will, and we ask it in prayer, do we have it? According to the Word of God, whatsoever we ask according to His asking prayer, we shall have it. What about if we go a little bit farther in Mark chapter 11, verse 30, Mark 11, 24.
"Therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and you shall have them."
So when you pray, believe, and ye shall have them. So we look in the book of Matthew, and I'll read this passage, Matthew 6:30, and then I'll read Matthew 8:26. Matthew 6:30 states, "Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall He not much more clothe ye of little faith?" And we would flip over to Matthew chapter 8, verse 26. "And He saith unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then He arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm." We can go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 8. "Which when Jesus perceived, He saith unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves, because ye have brought no bread?" He called them little faith. He rebuked them. What did He mean by little faith? What's one word we could throw in there that we've been talking about? They doubted. They were fearful. They weren't sure. They were lacking confidence. And Jesus rebuked them. When we look at these passages here, including Luke 12 and 28, there's one more passage where Jesus uses the phrase, "O ye of little faith." If you ever study the Word of God, well, and study it, try to look at the Greek in the verse and see how it's used versus other verses. Normally you'll find a Greek word here for a word or two or a noun, or you might see a Greek word for that little section. But O ye of little faith is all described in one Greek word. In one Greek word. And this is what it means. Incredulous, or for example, lacking confidence. That whole phrase, O ye of little faith, in the Greek, in one word, literally means lacking confidence. Doubt is the enemy of faith. If we are going to step out of faith, we're not doing it with uncertainty or doubt, but we step out in confidence. If you don't have confidence, you don't have faith. Because doubt and faith do not go hand in hand, but rather they are on opposite ends of the spectrum. They are diabolically opposed. Faith cannot be in action when one is lacking confidence. If you doubt, you don't have faith. We go back to the phrase that's on the opening page of last week's lesson. Faith is not hoping that God will do it. Faith is knowing that God will do it. Faith is not hoping that God will do it. Faith is knowing that God will do it. Jesus rebuked the disciples because they didn't have faith. He rebuked the disciples because they doubted. He rebuked the disciples in the passages that I just read from Matthew 6:30, Matthew 8:26, and 16:8 because they were lacking confidence. When we look at the book of James, he talks about faith and prayer. And I think it's chapter 1. We've already gone over this in the past. And if we haven't, I've almost possibly gone over in Sunday school, if not on Tuesday nights as well. But we love to use that phrase, that verse, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You need to get right with God. You can't sin and come to church. You can't sin and serve God. You got to get right with God. You can't ride the fence. Double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. That's not what that verse is talking about. When we study it and look at that passage, it's talking about prayer and faith. And a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways because why? He's lacking confidence. He might be okay with God over here and say, yes, God can do that, but can God do that? Yes, I know God said this in his word. I believe that I am forgiven, but can he heal the sick? Or is it God's time for this person to be healed? Sometimes we can have faith in one area and lack in the other. But faith and doubt are diabolically opposed. You cannot have both at the same time. Why? As we've already seen, faith and hope are surrounded in confidence, not doubt. If you're doubting, it's not faith. We saw that in the passage we just read again. That one Greek word that is used to describe that whole phrase, O ye of little faith. O ye of little faith. What does it mean? Lacking confidence in Christ. That's literally what it means. There are no other meanings to this verse, to this word. I know sometimes you get the dictionary out and you see, oh, this word, and then you'll have like 17 different meanings. Depends on how it's used. When you just look this up in Strong's Greek dictionary, there's literally one meaning to it. Lacking faith in Christ. So either we're going to have faith, either we're going to have confidence in Christ, or we're not. Before we move on, does anybody have any thoughts, any questions, anything they want to add at this point?
Yes.